I know what's coming up, so I'm excited for you, the listener, on today's Paperback Warrior podcast.
My name is Eric, and thanks for tuning in to episode 48 of the Paperback Warrior podcast. We do serious analysis of disposable literature. The show's a spinoff of our blog at paperbackwarrior.com. You can find new reviews almost every single day and podcast every Monday. We're also active on social media. Let me introduce my co-host, Tom, to talk about what we're doing today.
All right, Eric, today we are going to break from our normal format, and we're going to discuss nothing except the Casca series by Barry Sadler. Now, there's a crazy story about what happened to the series after Mr. Sadler died, and we did some real live investigative journalism to get to the bottom of the matter. It's kind of like what you hear on those way more successful true crime podcasts. This one is a real rabbit hole, Eric, and it's likely going to take a long time to tell the story, so I don't think we're going to have time for a whole bunch of reviews this week, but I'm asking the reader, even if you're not into Casca, you should stay with us because this story gets crazy. Anything else you need to say before we walk into the spider web of a feature and probably get ourselves sued?
You told me that this was going to be a very controversial episode, so I consulted my attorney. I made sure my will was all set and good to go. I left instructions in my safe back at the house, so I think I'm ready to go as a listener. I'm not involved in this.
All right, profiles and courage. So play the transition music. All right, I should say that Eric does not know this story. We often do show notes, and we kind of go through them before each episode. I have not given Eric any show notes. When we collaborate on the outlines for these podcasts, what I want Eric to do is experience this as a listener, basically a proxy for you riding in your car right now, so he can ask me the same questions that might be bothering you, the listener, as this story unfolds. Okay, Eric, before we get into the feature, I want to play you the beginning of this song. I want to want you to tell me if you know anything about it.
Fighting soldiers from the sky.
It's a real headbanger, huh?
Yeah.
Fearless men who jump and die.
Have you heard this before?
It's one of my dad's favorite songs.
You're kidding me.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
Just what they say. Yeah. The brave men of the Green Beret.
Did your dad serve as a Green Beret?
A lot of my uncles did. My dad was in the Army for 4 years.
Well, then you know who sang that song.
Yes.
Okay, good. That song was an absolute hit on RCA Records by U.S. Army Special Forces Staff Sergeant Barry Sadler in 1966. Now, Sadler lived from 1940 to 1989. He was born in New Mexico and raised by his mother after his dad died at an early age. Sadler dropped out of high school in the 10th grade in Colorado and joined the Air Force at age 17 during 1958, and he got his GED there. He served as a radio technician in Japan with the Air Force. This is interesting to me. He gets discharged from the Air Force in 1961 and immediately enlists in the Army, volunteering to be a medic in the Special Forces. In 1965, he gets sent to Vietnam, which I think might have been French Indonesia at the time. Yeah, I'm sorry, French Indochina at the time. And he gets injured on a combat patrol when he steps on one of those punji sticks.
Yeah.
Ugh, awful. It gets infected. He gets sent back to Fort Bragg to recover. That year, Sadler wrote this odd patriotic pop music hit with the Ballad of the Green Berets, the song I just played you. Here's another weird little factoid. The lyrics of the song were co-written by Sadler's friend, Robin Moore, who wrote a novel called The Green Berets that was later made into the 1968 movie starring John Wayne. The song was released at the beginning of 1966 and was number one on the Billboard charts for 5 consecutive weeks and sold 9 million copies.
Isn't that crazy?
Can you imagine?
It's nuts.
It's like Britney Spears numbers. He even performed the song live on the Ed Sullivan Show. So by 1968, Sadler settles down in Nashville and tries his hand at writing fiction. He finally finds commercial success in 1979 with a hit novel that sparked the series Casca. The Eternal Warrior, it was called. Now, the premise of the series is interesting. It's called this. It's basically this. Around the time of Jesus, Casca was a soldier in the Roman Legion who had fought for the Roman Empire heroically in many campaigns. Now, Casca found himself at Golgotha at the time of Christ's crucifixion. He sees Jesus on top of the cross suffering and decides to put Jesus out of his misery. So Casca, this Roman legionnaire, stabs Christ in the side. Now, Jesus condemns Casca by saying, "Soldier, you are content with what you are. Then that you shall remain until we meet again. As I go now to my Father, you must one day come to me." Jesus then dies, and his blood falls onto Casca's hand. Casca then tastes the blood of Christ, causing him to convulse. Now, this is Jesus' only appearance in the series. So Casca winds up working in a mining camp for 30 years, and he discovers, much like me, that he's not aging. One day he gets you like that? One day he gets stabbed, and the wound heals the next day. Now, Casca thinks about what Jesus said, and it occurs to him that he can feel pain, but he can't die. He's doomed to spend the rest of eternity as a soldier, fighting battles, learning languages, and not dying until Christ returns. Now, to be clear, Eric, this is not a religious or a Christian series like, say, the Left Behind books. The Casca series is basically a historical fiction series that finds Casca fighting in various violent wars over the past 2,000 years. The Jesus thing was just kind of a jumping off point, an origin story for Casca, the Eternal Warrior. So I read the first book of the series years ago before I started writing for your website, and I really liked it. It opens during the Vietnam War when a soldier with multiple gunshot wounds is brought to a surgeon. The hurt soldier is Casca, and it's clear that he's going to die from these wounds. He's got a large mortar shell fragment lodged in his skull and brain. The surgeon sees the soldier's body is covered in all these old, old scars. And somehow the soldier, who's Casca, of course, survives basically being blown to bits. Now, the surgeon becomes part of the series and basically is chronicling Casca's stories of battles he's fought over the past 2,000 years. It was a great book and was told very well in flashbacks. Now, Casca Book 2 is also reviewed on Paperback Warrior by our old friend Chris Snowden. In this one, Casca leaves the Roman Empire and hooks up with the Vikings. He sails across the Atlantic and actually discovers America. He heads down to Mexico and has an adventure with a primitive civilization there at that time. These books jump around throughout history, so it's not like they're following any logical path from the year zero to the year Vietnam War. Casca Book 4 is a fan favorite. It's called Panzer Soldier. In this one, Casca is using the name Karl Langer, and he's leading a four-man German tank crew on the Russian front during World War II. Snowden's review at Paperback Warrior describes the book as riveting and powerful, and he recommends it highly. So Sadler wrote 22 books in the Casca series, and Book 22 was his last. And it was titled The Mongol from 1990, finding Casca with Genghis Khan. So Casca was a guy who got around. The book was published a few months after Sadler's death, and I think there's widespread agreement that the Sadler installments were the best in the series. Fans loved these books and continue to love them to this very day. So the series continues, and actually still is continuing. It's on installment 52 now, but Sadler is dead. He's written 22 books, and how we get from 22 to 52 is one of the most controversial stories in men's adventure fiction. And it first bubbled up into my consciousness, and actually your consciousness, because you pointed it out to me, on the comments page of one of our Casca reviews on paperbackwarrior.com. In Panzer Soldier review, there was a guy who commented that he wrote some Casca books, and his sign-on name was like unknown, and then went nuts there. Like, people started piling on this guy in our comments, calling him a thief, a plagiarist, saying he should be in jail. I noticed when you go to the Casca Wikipedia page, they indicate that there are two episodes of the Casca series and the numbered series that are no longer canon and because they were believed to have been plagiarized by the author. And if you go to the official Casca page, there's also a very brief notation to that as well. So let's go back and figure out how we get there. The year's 1990. Casca remains a popular and successful franchise, but Barry Sadler's dead. The series kind of dies with him, and the rights reverted to Sadler's widow, a woman named Lavona Sadler. And as a partner, she partners with Sadler's literary agent at the time, a guy named Gary Sizemore. So Lavona and Gary are 50-50 partners. They employ a guy named Paul Dengelegi to continue the series and write two books, Casca the Liberator, published in 1999, and Casca the Defiant. Now, Paul's contract with them ends in 2001, and the publisher, Berkeley, dumps the series. So this Paul character, who is the ghostwriter for the first two books, he's no longer a character in the right. story I'm going to tell. But then there's a fellow named Tony Roberts, and he becomes a very important character in the story. I interviewed Tony Roberts for this feature. He was a Casca super fan who devoured all of Sadler's books in the 1990s. On his own, he began writing Casca stories in 1995, and he launched a Casca fan website, and he gets permission from the estate to call it the official Casca site. It became a place for Casca fans to kind of gather and discuss the series. One of these fans was a guy named Michael Goodwin, okay, also known as Mike Goodwin, who I also interviewed extensively. He and Tony would go back and forth in emails talking about the series, which was dying on the vine in the early 2000s. A man named Gail, and he's a guy named Gail Ryan, he was a literary agent who worked with Gary Sizemore, Sadler's old agent, who left the business. So Gary Ryan then steps in and becomes 50-50 partners with Mrs. Sadler in the Casca franchise. Now, Gail becomes an important character in the story because he basically becomes the referee when allegations of plagiarism start flying. At some point, Gail starts a company to keep the old Casca books in print and commission new writers for the series, right? Because Berkeley's out, and now this Gail character has the rights, basically, to everything.
And the widow's still alive, correct?
At some point, she dies, and then Sadler's two kids become kind of silent partners with Gail, is my understanding. But that's not really important. Like, nobody has an interest in like this thing except for Gail. Mm. This is where Tony Roberts gets his big break. It's 2005, and Tony has manuscripts for five Casca novels that he wrote on spec. Gail contacts Tony, and Tony sends him one of his stories. Gail, the publisher, asks Tony to write one set in the American Civil War and another in the Spanish-American War. Tony does the work, and before you know it, he's got three published books in the Casca series, plus control of the official Casca website.
Wow.
You following that? Right?
His dreams have come true.
Kind of, yeah. It'd be like a Star Wars fan getting to write and direct a Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
So once Tony gets writing, that other fellow fan that he meets online, Mike Goodwin, wants to follow suit. Now, Goodwin was also writing stories on spec, just like Tony was. And these guys would share ideas, send drafts to each other, offer suggestions. They were online friends who later, Eric, become sworn enemies, as you're about to hear about. Both dudes were super nice and helpful to me, so I'm not picking favorites. One thing they agree on is that they both think each other's Casca books suck.
Okay.
Right? That's the only thing that you can get these guys to agree on, is they think the other guy's Casca books are garbage.
Well, let me ask you this. Does Gail like Mike Goodwin's books or just Tony's?
So Michael Goodwin works out a deal with Gail for two books, Casca number 29, Immortal Dragon, and Casca number 33, The Outlaw. Now, according to Michael, now Gail's dead, but I didn't have a chance to interview him. According to Michael, who I did talk to, they were very well received by fans and they sold well. Michael says that Gail was thrilled with these books and their performance because the other guy, Tony, was writing a bunch of medieval stories.
Okay.
But Goodwin was like bringing him forward in time into like the cowboy era, like basically writing westerns and stuff. That's what he's hearing from Gail, at least, and that's what he says. Now, the fans start sniping at each other online. Both guys become consumed with jealousy toward each other, and this real internet feud with negative reviews being posted on each other's reviews for their books. They're like, you know, the Michael camp and the Tony camp are like basically taking shots at each other in the reviews for these books, which on the Amazon pages, which isn't helping the franchise at all, right? So in 2010, this is where it gets crazy. Another Casca superfan named John Thompson, who I interviewed, was reading Casca number 29, Immortal Dragon, one of the Mike Goodwin ones. And Thompson begins to suspect that Michael Goodwin may have plagiarized the story for Immortal Dragon from David Morrell's book, Rambo 3.
What?
Yeah.
Wait.
Yeah, so
Rambo 3?
Right. So he's reading this and he starts seeing Casca in like a camp with a, you know, with a bow and arrow and stuff. And you start thinking, this sounds like Rambo. But Thompson, who's a nice guy, doesn't do any kind of side-by-side analysis to compare the words on the page. The plot just reminded him of Rambo 3's plot. So John Thompson shares his suspicions with another Casca super fan named James Nollet, who becomes basically this vigilante working day and night to tear down Michael Goodwin and prove that he's a plagiarist. Now, when you hear the whole story, you can decide if Mr. Nollet's a hero or a villain. Now, I interviewed Nollet as well, and he claims that he put Casca number 29, Immortal Dragon, side by side with Rambo 3 and came to the conclusion that David Morrell was plagiarized by Michael Goodwin.
Okay, so if you're Michael Goodwin and you're looking to write a book, right? There's literally hundreds and hundreds of unknown paperbacks out there that no one's probably read. Why would you pick this huge blockbuster?
I asked the same question. Right? So I interviewed Nollet, and I asked for specifics. Now, I read a hell of a lot of pulp fiction. You do, too. And one thing you do is you see the same stories over and over and over again, right? The thief who gets pulled back for one last heist. The guy who's going to kill his lover's husband so they could share the money one more time. In a Western, the aging fastest draw in the West who wants to retire but keeps getting challenged by young quick draws looking to make a name for themselves. These plots are recycled again and again and again in pulp fiction. And I got to tell you, I don't think that's plagiarism. And it wasn't clear to me from my initial interviews with Nollet, who's an older fella and not very tech savvy, exactly what he meant by plagiarism. Okay, exactly if he meant like copying of words and phrases. Nollet claims, though, that he placed Rambo 3 and Casca 29 Immortal Dragon side by side. And Nollet told me that the first 60 pages of Casca number 29 was stolen from Rambo 3. He wasn't clear to me initially if it was just the plot or scene-by-scene action or actual paragraphs copied by David Morrell, because we're going back and forth in emails, like fast and furious.
Yeah.
Nollet claims that he began doing some homework on Michael Goodwin's other published Casca novel, this Western called Casca the Outlaw, which was Casca number 33. Nollet tells me that he found something even more disturbing, that Nollet says that Casca 33, the Outlaw, was plagiarized from a book called The Trespassers by Andrew Fenady. Heard of him?
No.
It was a leisure book release from 2008. As an aside, Fenady just died in April 2020, so I never got a chance to interview him for this story. So Nollet wrote me an email basically saying, and this is a quote, Casca the Outlaw was in fact stolen from Andrew Fenady's The Trespassers. By my count, Nollet says, about 91% of the materials in that fake book were stolen from Fenady. And the angle of the Japanese girl in Goodwin's fake book was stolen from the movie Red Sun with Charles Bronson. I add here that I went through both books very carefully, page by page, and I kept a running tally of how many pages were 100% plagiarized, how many were 80% or 0%, and then afterward I did arithmetic to figure out the overall plagiarism rate, and I came up with 91%.
Wow.
This is what Nollet's telling me, right?
Okay.
So he believes, Nollet believes this plagiarism took place, and then he gets with Tony Roberts, like, because he's part of like Team Tony in this feud. And so it's unclear to me who actually went to the publisher, but they go to Gail Ryan finally, the publisher of the Casca series. At first, Gail seems totally uninterested. He calls up Michael Goodwin, who denies outright any plagiarism. At this point, Goodwin also has three other Casca books in the pipeline to be published by Gail. And Gail allegedly was excited to publish them.
Okay.
But Michael Goodwin's claim to me is that there was drama escalating with the fans, all this nonsense happening online, like submarining each other. And he didn't want any part of this. And, you know, Roberts fans were taking pot shots at Michael Goodwin online. He didn't want any of the drama, he said. So his story to me is that basically he quits and takes his three unpublished Casca manuscripts with him. Mike Goodwin blames Tony Roberts for the breakup, but he said the breakup between Mike Goodwin and Casca had nothing to do with plagiarism. It was just because of this war that was happening in this dysfunctional Casca family.
Hmm.
So we're going to get to Mike's side of the story regarding the plagiarism in a minute, but let me give you an epilogue for Casca and the reason we know this. So Mike Goodwin takes his three unpublished Casca novels and self-publishes them on Kindle as the Cain, C-A-I-N series, basically taking Cain from the Cain and Abel story, Adam and Eve's child, and makes him the eternal warrior.
Oh, okay.
Right? So kind of a pastiche. I mean, it's not ideal, but it's no worse to me than Solar Pons creating a Sherlock Holmes-esque character. And he had the books in the can. I think kind of using Cain as Cain and Abel is a pretty clever idea. So Roberts continues writing the Casca books, and now we're up to book 52. But after Goodwin left, Gale keeps selling Michael Goodwin's Casca titles, right? Because he hears rumors of plagiarism. He doesn't do any kind of text analysis. He continues selling them until 2012 when everything hits the fan.
Mm, okay.
This fellow James Nollet, this kind of book police guy,
yeah.
He goes on David Morrell's Facebook page on November 28, 2012. I have a copy of the posting here. And he tells Morrell that Morrell is a victim of plagiarism. And so I have the screenshot here. It's, "Dear Mr. Morrell," this is on his Facebook page. You can look at it today. "You are the victim of plagiarism. Someone named Michael B. Goodwin plagiarized your Rambo 3 in his story, Casca, Immortal Dragon, which is available as a print version on Amazon. I can find no electronic or Kindle version of this product. Please contact me at blah, blah, blah. You are not Goodwin's only victim. He stole from others as well, blah, 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 blah." And so David Morrell, in his comments to this Facebook posting on David Morrell's page, seems concerned. Says, thank you, James. I'll contact Terry McCarthy. He's like, and then later he says, "James, how bad is this plagiarism? Is it word for word or just chunks of the plot?" So it sounds like Morrell's concerned. And I can only think that this guy, Terry McCarthy, is either Morrell's attorney or his literary agent. I reached out for David Morrell for comment, and I received no response. But I did talk to some people who had screenshots of emails that Morrell had CC'd people on as he's kind of trying to get to the bottom of this. The story I was told that's supported by these emails is that Morrell's attorney writes a cease and desist letter to Gale, the publisher of the Casca series. And Gale pulls the two Michael Goodwin titles, one of which may have been ripped off from Rambo 3, and the other was maybe ripped off from this other Western by Fennedy, down. And so, again, Gale's dead right now. The official Casca website that Tony Roberts controls has this notation that books 29 and 33 have been found to be plagiarized and are not part of the Casca canon. A notation to this effect is also on the Casca Wikipedia page, like I said earlier, and pops up whenever you discuss it in Men's Adventure Facebook groups. So Nollet has not been satisfied with this result of his Casca investigation, and he began analyzing the Cain books written by Michael Goodwin as well. Nollet claims that they were plagiarized as well.
What?
Yeah, and I want to set that issue aside, and we'll get to that. But this guy Nollet has... it's like his entire life's work right now is showing that Michael Goodwin is a plagiarist or a serial plagiarist. It's important to note that James Nollet and John Thompson, and to a certain extent John Roberts, have been unwilling to let this issue lie. Nollet has posted reviews on every forum imaginable, including our comments section, calling Michael B. Goodwin a thief and laying out a version of the case that he made to me on the phone, on emails. It's like he's sworn to ruin Mike Goodwin's life for this alleged plagiarism infraction.
It reminds me of the Tiger King and Karen Baskins.
Kind of, yeah, yeah. And Mike Goodwin, though, to his credit, I guess, has been pretty silent about these allegations. And so until now, because I'm going to tell you what happened, I felt really uncomfortable walking into this because I, again, it wasn't clear to me from Nollet's story what's really happening here, whether we're talking just general plot type things, or whether we're talking word-for-word plagiarism. I'm also really sensitive to the idea of cyberbullying. I hate that. I also don't like public shaming of people who make mistakes. I think it's one of the worst things in our society. And Eric, as your partner in this venture, it would kill me to know that we are providing a forum on Paperback Warrior in their comment section to allow a good man to be like bullied on some nonsense charges.
Right.
So I reach out to Mike Goodwin a couple days ago, and we had a long, long continuing text dialogue that's completely on the record here because I told him it's on the record. And so you have to understand that Casca number 29, Immortal Dragon, the one allegedly ripped off from Rambo 3, was Goodwin's first novel. And remember, it also kind of started out as a piece of Casca fan fiction,
right?
Written on spec. So I began the conversation with Goodwin, giving him an easy out. It could have been a rookie error or an error in judgment or something inadvertent. And the next thing you know, he's sold the book and he's on this runaway train who can't escape. I could totally see that happening to like a young fan fiction author.
Right.
And it doesn't make him John Dillinger.
Right.
But Mike didn't take the bait. After giving him excuses that I could understand, Mike said that the plagiarism allegations are total BS. Denies them outright. I said, have you ever read David Morrell's Rambo 3 before you wrote Immortal Dragon? He said, no. He said, I'd seen the movie tons of times. We all had. And he said that there are similarities between his book and Rambo 3, but his story was really, really different overall. I asked him the same question about Casca 33, The Orphan, the book that Nollet said was 91% plagiarized from Andrew Fennedy's The Trespassers. Mike denied having read Fennedy's books at all before writing Casca 33. Now, after the allegations surfaced, Mike said the curiosity got the best of him, so he gets a copy of The Trespassers, the book. Mike reads the books and sees that there are similarities between the two novels and that it was quite uncanny, in his words, but still different. Mike said he had never heard of Fennedy until the allegations came out.
Hmm.
So Mike is totally unaware of what happened behind the scenes after he quit Casca that led to the banning of his books and the removal of them from the Casca canon. He always wrote it off to sort of the feud in that, you know, Tony sort of is running the show these days. Mike is adamant about his innocence, and he seemed very credible to me. He invited me to his house to come watch him write. I'm not really sure what that would have proven. He's working on a new Kane novel called Kane the Viking, and he's very irritated that Nollet and those guys keep maligning him online, calling him a thief. But it's also clear to me that he wants to move on. He doesn't want this controversy to define him. So Mike said to me twice that if he plagiarized these books, why hasn't he been sued? Now, I pointed out to him that the juice isn't always worth the squeeze for an alleged victim in a civil suit.
Right.
There's legal fees involved. It's really the same. I said, Mike, it's the same reason that you're not suing Nollet for smearing your good name on the internet. You know, it's just at some point it's not worth it.
Right.
So as a journalist investigating this, I'm left at this point of the story, at least, not knowing who to believe. Now, an unintended consequence to this controversy, Eric, is that Casca 29 and 33, the banned books, are huge collector's items. They're going for hundreds of dollars online.
Mm.
And I wanted to put these books side by side with the Rambo and the Fennedy books to see if the words were lifted. And to me, that's the real issue here. And I think maybe you can agree with me. The writers among us who listen, and we get a lot of authors who listen, they'll argue that the plot really shouldn't be stolen either. And I get that. But that's a gray area. And I'd be a bad judge of that. But if Mike is stealing entire paragraphs or pages from Rambo 3 and The Trespassers, that's clearly not allowed. And it means he lied to me. Right. Which also isn't allowed because lying to a podcaster is a federal crime.
It should be.
Right. So are we in agreement that that's sort of the how this thing needs to be measured is not just a general plot? Or what are your thoughts at this point of the story? Because we're getting to the punchline.
I would think when you brought in David Morrell, I think that brings a huge sense of validity to the suspecting of him plagiarizing. And I would assume that Morrell and this attorney or literary agent or whatever pursued both copies of the book or his copy of the book, I should say, in comparing it to Morrell's work. And they saw a clear evidence of plagiarism. And that's why the cease and desist was issued. Morrell brings validity to it.
Okay. Well, that's you're thinking right. So I ask Mike if he happens to have a bootleg doc or Mobi file for his Casca books that he could send me because I want to clear his good name. Right. And he says he doesn't have one, which seemed weird. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, well, do you have either paperback? You send it to me. I'll send it back. You know, I live in Florida. I'm easy to find. You'll have my address. I'm not a book thief. And he says he doesn't have them.
Okay.
I had to say that I found that a little bit suspicious, but who knows? Right. It's not, you know, it doesn't make him guilty. So I asked Tony Roberts for digital versions of Casca 29 and 33. And he also doesn't have them. Also very weird. So I asked both Nollet and Thompson, the guys who allegedly discovered this, for either the ebooks or photos of the offending pages or passages. And both guys say, oh, give me some time, I'll pull it together for you.
Yeah.
So as I'm waiting to get the evidence myself, I still don't know who to believe at this point of the story. In text messages and emails, every single one of these guys was very cool and nice and seemed credible. I understand that Mike wants to move on, and I don't understand why Nollet is flooding Paperback Warrior with comments about this issue a decade later. I needed to see for myself, right? I'm totally coming into this with an open mind.
Right.
And then I got the evidence. And I got to tell you, Eric, putting the two texts side by side was incredibly disturbing.
Oh, no.
I don't think Mike was completely honest with me in our initial back and forth. And so what I want to do here, I want to hand this to you.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Okay, so we're going to do a dramatic reading where you're going to be the Andrew Fennedy.
Oh, this is interesting. Okay.
And I'm going to read the Casca part.
Oh, geez.
And so what chapter is this of Andrew Fennedy's,
This is chapter 2 of The Trespassers.
Okay. I want you to read either the first sentence or the first paragraph. You see how it breaks down.
Mm-hmm.
So you're Andrew Fennedy, The Trespassers, chapter 2. I'm reading chapter 2 of The Outlaw, which is Casca number 33.
Do you want to do it at the same time?
No. You read a sentence and then hand it over to me and I'll read a sentence. And so listeners can compare the two and see if they're similar enough to be counting as plagiarism.
Oh, good. Okay. So again, this is Andrew J. Fennedy's The Trespassers, chapter 2, the first paragraph. Some men know each other, talk to each other, travel miles and miles together for days, months, even years, and never really get to understand each other, at least not enough to feel any kinship between them.
You pause. Chapter 2 of the Casca book. Some men know each other, talk to each other, travel miles and miles together for days, months, even years, and never really get to understand each other, at least not enough to feel kinship between them. Okay, your turn.
The opposite was true of Jefferson Keyes and the man called Elijah.
The opposite was true of Case Lonergan and the samurai called Sayo.
As the two rode together toward the town of Bootjack, leading the dun, carrying the curved body of Pete Bass wrapped in a blanket, they had known each other just a few hours and less than 100 words had passed between them.
As the two rode together toward the town of Red Rock, Case led Mad Jack's horse with his body draped over the saddle. The two very different men had known each other for only a few hours and less than 100 words had passed between them. Read one more sentence.
But neither of them had the slightest doubt about the other man's integrity.
But neither of them had the slightest doubt about the other man's integrity. You can set that aside now. What do you think?
To be blunt, Mike Goodwin's a damn liar.
It's word for word, Eric. This is no accident. I have pages and pages and pages of examples, and it's all word for word the same.
Wow.
I was really disappointed because I actually kind of believed Mike's denials at first, like maybe he's being internet bullied. And he was so nice on and seemingly transparent. He was telling me he had nothing to hide, and it wasn't until I started pushing for a text comparison that he clammed up. I want to do the same exercise here. For Rambo 3, you're going to be Rambo 3, and I wrote here, start here, and we'll do the same thing, basically, read a paragraph or a sentence.
Okay.
And again, you're reading Rambo, I'm reading Casca 29.
And this is Rambo 3, correct?
Rambo 3, right.
Okay, by David Morrell. The golden-toothed referee scampered from the ring. Rambo's opponent, a tall, husky Thai, strode forward with contempt to crush the ideal enemy, the ultimate inferior, a round eye.
Stop. Okay. The golden-toothed referee scampered from the ring. Casca's opponent, a huge Asian with long, wild hair, reminding Casca of one of those Japanese sumo wrestlers, strode forward with contempt to crush the ideal enemy, the ultimate inferior, a round eye.
Rambo avoided his initial kick, parried a blow from the wood in his fist, pivoted and thrust with his own foot.
Casca avoided the initial kick, parried a blow from the wooden stick in his fist, pivoted and thrust with his own foot.
But he didn't stretch to his full capacity.
But he didn't stretch to his full capacity.
What's wrong with me?
What's wrong with me?
His opponent twisted from Rambo's held back kick and countered with a savage combination of a stick to Rambo's chest and a calloused foot to Rambo's side.
His opponent twisted from Casca's held back kick and countered with a savage combination of a stick to Casca's chest and a calloused foot to Casca's side.
Rambo stumbled back in pain.
Casca stumbled back in pain.
He felt powerless.
He felt powerless.
His opponent stunned him with a brutal flurry of kicks and stick strikes. Blood poured from Rambo's forehead.
His opponent stunned him with a brutal flurry of kicks and stick strikes, blood poured from Casca's forehead.
His body wouldn't respond. He was struck by foot and stick again and again. He lurched farther back, raised his arms to defend himself, but his will resisted.
His body wouldn't respond. He was struck by foot and stick again and again. He lurched farther back, raised his arms to defend himself, but his will resisted. Let's stop there just because this is getting tedious. See,
that is absolutely ridiculous.
Isn't that crazy? And so,
so is he just a pathological liar? He can't tell the truth?
I don't know, man. So, which is weird because at the very when I asked him this, he could have just told me that he didn't want to talk about it, but that's not what he did. Instead, he lied. And so, Mr. Nollet wanted me to send me similar evidence that his Kane books were also copied from other books that I have in my library, but I didn't want to kind of get into that too much. What I want to do, though, so after this comes to my attention, and we're running long here, but we'll figure out how to edit this and make it so people can hear it, because I think this is important to get to the bottom of. I reach out for Mike again after I got this evidence and saw what we just read to each other. And I sent him a text message, and I'm not going to read you every text message, but I kind of cut and pasted highlights. I said, listen, Mike, I got the books and did a comparison. There's issues we should probably discuss. My goal is not to embarrass you. You're a family man and a veteran. I understand how a young author writing essentially fan fiction could find himself then being published and could make this mistake. I get it, but we should clear the air and discuss what occurred. If you don't want to talk about it, that's fine. Just let me know and I'll go away. So he sends me a message saying, yeah, I got some time available. What's up? I said, I've been comparing texts between both Rambo 3 and The Trespassers and your two Casca books. Mike, there's entire pages lifted verbatim from both books. I could send you exemplars, but I'd rather just talk it out here because I think you may have told me some things yesterday that don't make a lot of sense now. Was this just a rookie mistake? And he said, like I stated, I also noticed comparisons, but overall, vast differences. I said, Mike, look at these. It's word for word. He goes, well, I don't recall in any of those books the exact characters and all their actions, but I admit that I did tell you I noted similarities. But if you read Immortal Dragon in its entirety, I think you'd see vast and complete differences in any Rambo film or any film that I know about. I said, listen, the differences aren't my focus. It's the identical passages. Did you copy them from the two books, Rambo 3 and Trespassers, as a tribute, perhaps? And he goes, no. I said, why did you copy the passages then? And he goes, I didn't. Oh, but you're only focusing on seemingly a portion of something, not the whole. And I said, there are so many, Mike. I could fill up your inbox. And then he goes, how can I copy something that me and the publisher Gale thought out somewhat together? Ideas, historical characters, and timelines, things of that nature. I go, it's the words, Mike. They're the same. Let's get past the idea that this didn't happen. Why did that occur? And he goes, why did what occur?
Oh, no.
I said, the direct copying of text from the other books. Did you consider it fair use or a pastiche? There are many reasonable explanations. He goes, I don't know what to tell you, Tom. Until those allegations, I had never even heard of that author.
He's lying.
Crazy. He goes, I wrote what I wrote, sending sample chapters back and forth with Gale, and I went from there. I go, Mike, that's not true. The words are the same. I want to defend you on my show, Mike, but in order to do that, I need you to level with me. The words are the same. And I send him some screenshots. He goes, well, and I send him the screenshots basically side by side.
Yeah.
He goes, well, how are you going to defend something like that? People are going to believe what they're going to believe. How are you going to change that? And I said, Mike, it's not a matter of believing or not believing. I think you borrowed passages from the other books to create a unique story of your own. Is that a fair characterization? Like a cover band who makes an old song their own by doing different version of the same tune and lyrics, or I effed up, it was a mistake, and I got caught. That's also a reasonable explanation. No one got hurt. And I go, but the it's all BS story from yesterday just wasn't true. And he goes, Tom, you can spin it any way you want, but this is my work. Just as Immortal Dragon is, Earth Redux, another one of his series, and others out and coming out. And I go, listen, there's nothing for me to spin. I just want to understand your perspective and how and why this happened. And he goes, how can I, if you haven't read them in their entirety? I said, I'm only interested in the passages that are the same. The quality of your original material isn't in question. I'm sure it's brilliant. Do you think this is a legitimate practice for an author? That seems to be what you're saying. And I'm curious. I'm not judging, Mike. And he goes, like I stated the other day, I noted the similarities, but overall, just like movies and TV, critics and others claim they stole it from so-and-so, or it's just like this, that, or the other. You know, I read that like I read about the movie Avatar, one among many. I go, they are the same words, Mike. That's the difference. You copied someone else's words and wove them into your book. Are you saying this is a legitimate thing to do? Or are you saying it was a lapse in judgment? Or just a guy starting out who didn't understand the rules? Please help me understand. And he goes, I don't know. It sounds to me like you're just looking for a lamb to slaughter. Maybe that makes for a better podcast. I don't know. Sounds like you want to hear something different. And if you heard that, how is that going to help me? This is Mike. It doesn't. And I've moved on long ago. Negative stuff may make your podcast and reviews seem more meaty and, I don't know, interesting. I said, Mike, I came into this wanting to defend you because these lunatics are stalking you online, calling you a thief. And they're using my comment section on my blog to do it. Yesterday, I thought I had a great segment about how these idiots were maligning you. Today, it turns out you lifted passages from some other people's books in your own original stories. It doesn't make you John Dillinger. I'd still like to defend you as a growing indie author who made some mistakes when you were starting out. It can be a cautionary tale for other young writers, but I can't do that until I understand your perspective as to why this occurred. And so then he gives me a little heart, like saying like he loves what I'm trying to say there, but it's not an admission of anything.
No.
He goes, look at it, he says, look at it as a whole. Read it all, both novels as well as the others. Then you can decide. All I told you the other day was the truth, the machinations, the infighting, people's backgrounds, which I only skimmed the surface on how it happened. Even if I told you what you seemingly want to hear, how is that going to help me? Or those who already believe that? It doesn't. And then he says that basically he has to go, that he's busy doing something else involving his family, which I don't need to get into. I said, listen, I believe everything else you told me about the dysfunction within the Casca franchise, all that's going into the podcast. But so are the allegations of plagiarism and the truth that it occurred. Without an explanation from you about how this occurred, it's only the others who get a voice. We're recording this next week. Let me know if you want to reconsider your position. I hope everything's okay with your family. Peace. And he says, thanks. I reached out for him today a couple hours before you got to my house, and he's got nothing further to add to this.
So it sounds like to me he's obviously removed the rearview mirror from the car. He's not looking back. He's looking forward. The other thing is, in his mind, he's got two things going on. In his mind, he's absolving himself from this act, the sin, by just coughing it up as like, you know, I'm Bob Kane and maybe I made Batman sort of like the Shadow. I just did something different with it. And there's no shame in that. You know, I created this whole new thing.
Right. He's focusing on the differences, yes. Not the fact that he lifted. Here's where it gets.
But he doesn't want to focus on that stuff because he knows that that's the bad parts.
Gets a little worse because he has these four Kane books that have been published. First one's called Mark of Kane. I did a comparison. It's word for word copied from a book called The Sword of Hannibal. Second one, Kane the Crusader, is copied word for word from a book you read and reviewed, Falcon Number One by Mark Ramsey. Remember that one?
I didn't read or review that.
Oh, I thought you did. I read it. The real author's John Maddox Roberts. Kane the Sufferer is copied from Gail Rivers' The Five Fingers. Mm. Kane the Wanderer is copied from another book by Andrew Fenerty called Double Eagles.
So he's just continuing to do this over and over.
I don't have the exact timeline, and I haven't read his new science fiction series. Nollet seems to think it might be stolen from Battlefield Earth by L. Ron Hubbard, but he hasn't done the word-by-word comparison, he said. So that's what we have. Again, I'm not here to crucify the poor guy. I gave him every chance in the world to offer any. I would be advocating for him right now if he said, dude, I screwed up. I did something very stupid.
Yeah,
because, man, I have done so many stupid things in my life. I'm in no position to throw stones at anybody. But he took this odd position. Anyway, none of this obviously takes anything away from the original Casca books by Barry Sadler, or for that matter, the continuation books by Mark Roberts. All the legit books are available on Kindle, and you can still find the original paperbacks in the wild. But it was just this weird rabbit hole I went down to try to defend a guy that I thought was being bullied on the internet, who turns out appears to be guilty as charged from lifting actual paragraphs.
Absolutely. And, we've definitely shown that today.
Right. So you, the listener, can join in on this conversation and let me know what you guys think. I think the best forum for that would be the Paperback Warrior page on Facebook. Now, we often hype the podcast on other Facebook groups, but if we could confine this to the Paperback Warrior Facebook group, I know Mike Goodwin's listening, and I know our listeners would love to hear your side of the story, and I hope I've treated you fairly today, and I know that Nollet and the other guys from the other camp who uncovered this thing are also listening to this podcast and follow Paperback Warrior on Facebook, and so you guys feel free to express your interest there. Let's try to keep it somewhat professional and civil. I'm not looking to, you know, into a bunch of name calling. I'd like to understand how this affects. And I know there's a lot of authors out there who treat plagiarism very, very seriously. Again, I don't think it's a death penalty type thing, but if I had put my heart, I've never written a book, and if I put my heart and soul into it and someone just stole it and put their name on it, I guess I'd be pretty irked by that.
Right. Yeah. I just can't think of any other way. You gave him an easy out on this whole thing. You've literally given him the tweezers to pull the thorn out after all these years of pain.
And again, he's got family issues. It don't need to be aired here. He's served in the military. Yeah. I verified that. Again, I'm not looking to crucify this guy. I just want to understand how this could occur. And he seems to want to move on, which is fine. And again, if he had said, no comment, I want to move on, I don't want to discuss this, all I can do is put my tail between my legs as a journalist and walk away. Anything else before we wrap up?
That's it.
Okay, well, that was the Paperback Warrior podcast. Next week, we're going to go back to a normal format. Thank you so much for your time and listening. Join us on Facebook to continue the discussion. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thanks.